Carmel has paid considerable attention to celebrating diverse cultures in very public ways. There's a Japanese garden just south of City Hall, the Mooncake Festival, the annual Holocaust Memorial Remembrance, and the Bastille Day celebration with the Alliance Francaise. As you know, our luncheons are typically on Wednesdays, but at the mayor's request, it's Thursday this year because Yom Kippur ended at sundown yesterday. Today marks the mayor's 23rd State of the City. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Mayor Jim Brainard.
Good afternoon. The state of the city of Carmel is tremendous. We live in a vibrant new city that competes as one of the best places to live and work anywhere. It is a place with beautiful parks and trails, great public schools, a vibrant and thriving downtown, but most of all, a place where government and business and non-government organizations work together to build a city where people and families from all backgrounds and all places can thrive and prosper and live productive lives. I'm deeply humbled to stand here today delivering the 24th State of the City Address. Beginning in January, we have another 4 years of work ahead of us, and I want you to know that I'm committed to continuing working on your behalf to grow Carmel into the best place to live, work, play, and raise a family, and retire, the best place to do all these things in America. This has not been an easy road. Few worthwhile things are easy. But you can see how our plans are all coming together now, particularly in our central corridor, along Rangeline Road, and the Monon Greenway. Instead of a rundown and underused center of Old Town Carmel, we have a vibrant and thriving mix of residents, corporate offices, and small businesses that are finding out quickly that Carmel has a strategy in place to support our local small businesses, a strategy to offer different types of housing, and a strategy to constantly attract more jobs and talented workers. And all these things make us a much stronger, more competitive city. I also have to work this in. I want to remind you that we have accomplished all these strategic goals while property taxes have declined. In fact, we continue to have one of the lowest property tax rates in all of Indiana. And this is important because there are still some who question the level of debt we carry as a growing city. Of course, what they fail to mention is the level of revenues we have as a city, or the small percentage of debt paid by our residential taxpayers. And that's the real story. We are a growing city, and we have been for the last 24 years. And that means we still need to invest in building new and safer streets, sidewalks, storm sewer and drainage systems, parking structures, parks and trails, and all the other things the city builds. We do these things to meet the needs of a population that has exceeded 100,000 at night and 125,000 people plus in the daytime. And it's because of our smart use, actually, of tax incremental finance, sometimes referred to as TIF, that we've been able to build this city that people love. We carefully use the revenue from the new developments, borrow against that revenue stream to support projects that are public amenities, such as the Palladium, the theaters, the parking garages, stormwater drainage and streets. In fact, we pay for many improvements with TIF that would otherwise have to be paid for out of residential property taxes. But by carefully using tax incremental financing, we can do these things without having to charge the residential taxpayers. It is a tool that has allowed us to build a great city while lowering property tax rates that residents pay. In fact, we're constantly asked by other city leaders across Indiana, the Midwest, and the United States for help in duplicating. They want to know how we have done this and kept our tax rates low. Our city revenues are more than sufficient to cover annual debt payments and the city will end 2019 with over $40 million in reserves. Yeah, that was meant to be an applause line. Growing cities require investments, and our growth has impacted many things. Among them is our classification as a city. The combination of our population number and the city council's approval has changed Carmel's city classification. So in 2020, we will become what Indiana law calls a second-class city, which means our city council will increase from 7 members to 9 members, and for the first time, we'll have an elected city clerk and an appointed controller. The city clerk will, among other things, serve as the secretary and record keeper for the city council and the city court, and the controller's responsibilities will include paying the city's bills and employees. While some things will change in that structure, the quality of our service will only continue to improve. We will continue to pave streets and plow snow and keep Carmel streets the best in all of central Indiana. We will continue to work on projects that improve drainage, link trails and pathways, and continue to make our streets easier and safer to navigate for our residents and visitors. We will continue to maintain ownership and control of our water and other utilities, which keeps our rates among the lowest of any city in Hamilton County. And we will continue to do the things we do to provide safe neighborhoods, excellent emergency services, emergency medical care, support for our wonderful schools, and ample opportunities to stay healthy and prosperous. We're pleased always to see that Carmel continues to rank high when contrasted to other places to live and work. Some question whether these rankings that we see more and more on the internet and magazines mean anything. But it is of value to be ranked among the best places to live and work because people and companies pay attention to these lists when deciding where to locate. These rankings always start with a statistical basis, data points that the companies doing the rankings choose, and then some dive deeper and actually come here and interview residents and businesses to get a feel for what life is like here. I know these rankings matter. In fact, I want to tell you a story. I was in the Art and Design District on my bicycle this Saturday, walked into Chocolate Art right there on Main Street, one of my favorite places, in fact. And there was a family there. It was a mother and father, you know, in their 60s, and a daughter and a grandchild and a husband in their 30s. And the grandfather looked at me and said, "You're the mayor, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "Well, I'm from Walnut Creek, California, but I read about you." And he said, "My daughter was raised in the Bay Area of California. She's a nurse at the hospital there. And we realized she and her husband weren't going to be able to afford a house. So we started to look at these rankings on the internet, and we looked at dozens of them. And Carmel's name popped up over and over and over again. So we came out here and visited it, and she's moved here with her family. So these rankings do matter. This is just Saturday. I've heard this story over and over as people look for places. I ran into a couple not too long ago that had a grandchild in Ohio and one in Wisconsin, and they thought about moving to Chicago. Then they read about Carmel in one of the magazine articles and chose to retire here. A few of our most recent awards just in the last few months include, according to Niche.com, number one best suburb to live in America. By Yahoo.com, we've heard of Yahoo, best place to raise a family in the Midwest. By Safewise.com, an insurance company, number one safest city to raise a child. We've also won awards for the quality of our developments and projects. Our Monon Boulevard and Midtown Plaza projects already won top awards for design. One of them, I think, the week before we even opened it. We received a community placemaking award from the Accelerate Indiana Municipalities, otherwise known as AIM. And this success is a result of a dedicated city team, creative community partners. I always joke, my job's easy. All I have to do is hire people smarter than I am. But we know it's a combination of hiring the right people, giving those people the tools that they need, letting them innovate, letting them create, and setting high standards for our city. And a group of colleagues has been tremendously important to the success of this city is our city council. I want them to stand for a minute and be recognized. I want Councilor Carter to stand back up because I want to give him special recognition. Ron Carter has been with me since our first term in 1996 and was in the trenches through our toughest battles, which led to the success of the Monon Greenway and the Center for the Performing Arts. He started the Farmers Market as a volunteer and has run that for over two decades. So to honor that legacy of service to his city, I recently announced at a farmer's market that the center green in front of the Palladium will be renamed Carter Green in honor of his decades of service to the city. Give Ron another big round of applause. Thank you, Ron. There's other elected officials here, members of boards and commissions. I'd like them all to stand for a minute. Give them all a round of applause. I see school board members, redevelopment commission members, redevelopment authority. We also appreciate our other partners who provide the community with outstanding top-rated services. We know that many are drawn to this city because of the high-quality public and private schools and the public library system that serves this community. We place a high priority in education, and we're fortunate to have top-rated partners in that effort. We appreciate all of our teachers, our school administrators, and their staff. I'd like all people associated with our school system to stand up and be recognized. Time, I have a short video to show the highlights, some of our partners in economic development, where they discuss what brought them to Carmel, and I thought you might like to hear from some of them.
People are looking for that experience. They want to go to a space where they can hit two or three places, whether it's to go dine or to go shop.
They're not only looking for just a place to live, but somewhere they want to be part of it, they want to belong to.
The people of Carmel are very, very nice. Everyone's very kind. It's like a family.
Fork and Ale House is a kitchen and brewery. It's just a really great place for families to come and connect and people to come in and have a great time. We don't have shorelines and we don't have mountains, so we have to create our experience. And I think that's something that we all need to do as local businesses, because I think the community and the city and really all of the leadership of Carmel has done for us. And they're really into creating the experience here. And our past concepts that we had, our Carmel location, far surpassed our other locations. And it truly is that sense of community, and people want independent operators to succeed.
Keystone Group is a diversified group of companies in real estate development, construction, property management, sports, entertainment, and investments. The mayor's bold vision to create a very vibrant city, very vibrant downtown, arts and design district, investing arts, public places to bring people together, make a great place to live, work, and play attracted us. And we see continuous investments in Carmel and in corporate headquarters, in residential, restaurants, retail, and infrastructure, the roundabouts, the artworks in the roundabouts, the civic theater, performing arts center, new hotel downtown, and that makes us more excited to continue to invest in Carmel.
think when you cross the threshold, you feel like you're somewhere else. And I wanted it to be very Disney-like in a way that when you enter the doors, you don't feel like you're in Indiana. You don't feel like you're anywhere but someplace that makes you happy. I chose Carmel because I can't imagine being anywhere better. It's a beautiful city. It's it's clean. It's safe. It's pretty. I have a lot of locals that come in that live close by that come and sit at the bar, and they have cocktails and they have dinner, and it's just really nice to be part of a community. And I think to me that's what Carmel is. It's about the community and the people that live there and the businesses that are there. And when we all support each other, then everybody thrives. And what I love about being part of this center is that there are other businesses that are around me, and we all take care of each other.
Twelve years ago, we saw that the climate was changing in Carmel. It was becoming very vibrant socially and also economically, and the city was really focusing on that.
One of the most important things as a business owner is basically making sure that your people, that you can attract and retain the best and the brightest people.
Today, going to work is not just a question of having a job. People care about where they work. They care about the space they work in. They care about the people they work with, and they also think about where the company's going.
Boy, it's amazing just when you look out my office window, the diversity within the community that we have. And it's vibrant and it's growing, and people feel that when they want to become a part of something that's very successful.
When you think of Car Global, that's car with a K, K-A-R. Think of us as the New York Stock Exchange for buying and selling vehicles. We transact over 5 million vehicles on an annual basis, on a global basis. I like to say all big businesses started out as a small business. And we started out as a very small business here in Central Indiana. And we're a Fortune 800 company now. And really, when you think about Central Indiana, and you think about Carmel in particular, you think about, it's a very good place to live. You know, you think about the things that are important to families. It's a great place to raise a family. The schools are fantastic. I think well known throughout the country. You know, the cost of living, taxes, crime is low. We were in a building that we were outgrowing, quite frankly. When you think about coming into this new campus, it is absolutely a game changer for us. The city worked with us in helping us create this building here. Not only are our employees excited, but the opportunity to recruit new employees, bring in new employees, has been stellar.
Our company is an advanced visualization company. We're a little bit different than a video production company. We focus on augmented reality and broadcast television. We create episodic television. We also service the film industry. We also service Fortune 100 companies. We are at the crossroads of America here. We're center point. So it allows us to access all of our clients very easily. I'm 20 minutes by flight to Chicago, or a couple hour drive. I'm an hour to New York. I'm a couple hours down to Florida, and about 3.5 hours out to LA. It is not a roadblock being here by any means. The City of Carmel and their economic development initiatives have allowed us as a business an opportunity to do business at less of a cost, to allow us to have growth.
Allied Solutions has been around since 1977. We provide tools such as risk management insurance to the financial institution marketplace. The vision of the city and the growth of the city has been phenomenal. And I think that's important. The mayor and the board out there, the vision that they've created. We're attracting young talent. We really are. I think that the millennials, Gen Y, Gen X, I think they really want a place that's kind of all-encompassing. A building that we built that's for that type of generation, so it's a very open space. Environment, and then just the community around it. There's more housing, there's more people that live right in this. So it's not just working for Allied, they're part of the culture and they're part of the community of Carmel.
Zotec Partners is a leading healthcare receivable management firm. So we manage the receivables for clients across the country who are in the healthcare space, turning their medical encounters into cash. The investment that the City of Carmel has made in culture has really made a difference in our ability to attract people, plus the overall manufacturing mentality with the value systems of Hoosiers and in Central Indiana. Our new building is an exciting investment here in Carmel. The city was very, very instrumental in working with the governor And the whole community basically came together to make sure that we had a package that not only helped us with the real estate, that's obviously part of it, the investment in the roads and the infrastructure so that we would support our building. And they were tremendous to work with. They had the right kind of mindset.
You know, people ask us all the time, are you going to open another location? Well, we have other liquor licenses to do that. I just don't know that we could find another location that's going to top this one.
I had a lot of people ask me to open up from all over the city of Indianapolis. The reason why I picked Carmel was because of the community and because of the way it looks and because of the people.
It's been a vibrant, vibrant city, and we've enjoyed being here, and we continue to grow here.
You know, personally, I moved here from Canada in 1996. There was no reason to leave. There was nowhere that I could think of going that we could get better treated than we're going to get treated right here in Central Indiana. I'm here for life. I'm now an adopted Hoosier.
Great video. Thanks to my staff for putting that together. That's the type of quality of work we get at City Hall, so thank you. We take care of the financial health of our city as well. You'd be surprised, I think, to know how many cities do not have a long-range fiscal plan or robust reserves. We model all major financial decisions, not for this year's impact, but for long-term fiscal impact. For instance, we add a police officer, we know it costs X amount, but what's that going to cost us over the next 15 years? That's the type of modeling we do, all the costs that will impact us decades down the road. As a result, we've managed to keep our tax rates among the lowest in Indiana and certainly much, much lower than most other states. Our utility rates are the lowest of neighboring cities, and this is an interesting chart. If you'll look at it for a minute, you'll see this is based on 6,000 gallons of water usage a month, which is the average residential usage. And then you look at our neighboring cities, and it's not city governments that set those rates. It's the private operators, because all those other cities have sold off their utilities for one-time cash infusions. And of course, those private companies pay dividends. They have to pay taxes. We don't. And I should call out our utility managers. I see some of them are here today. They do a wonderful job of managing, but to a person on Social Security or a retirement income, a small pension, those differences in annual savings do make a difference to them. Carmel utility customers pay $560 less than their Indianapolis neighbors. We have a good bond rating. We have a AA rating by Standard & Poor's, which places us in the top 25% of all U.S. cities. We made it through the last recession well without laying off one city employee. We project, as I mentioned, more than $40 million in all reserve funds at the end of 2019. And first and foremost, I think we all get excited about all the new buildings and all the new things that we do, the exciting things, the sculpture and so on. But first, and this is the essence of local government, we pay attention to the best basic services possible. I don't think it's significant, and it should not be overlooked or downplayed that we've made certain that our water quality, our street network, our lighting, our wastewater services, our street cleaning. I followed a street cleaner over here today. Our stormwater system are improved and maintained ahead of development. Some cities cannot even accept new development because they don't have the capacity in their water or wastewater systems to do so. This has been a rare opportunity for me personally. It's been such an honor to have served the City of Carmel at a time when it's been transformative. We've had the opportunity to work together with all our private sector partners to build, in essence, a brand new city. And I've never taken it for granted. It's a picture of City Center. If you remember that 24 years ago, it was City Center Drive, wasn't there? That was a three-way corner. There were 60 acres of farmland and some older buildings in that site. But my first election campaign, I heard over and over from people that they wanted a downtown. They wanted a place that they could take visitors to. They wanted a place to go out to eat dinner and not have to drive somewhere. And they wanted something that was beautiful and something they could be proud of. And so we started to analyze the financial and legal impediments. Why are cities basically made up of big, ugly parking lots? I always joke, you know, anybody go for a romantic walk past the big box parking lot lately? And so how do we build a more beautiful city that's walkable and pedestrian friendly and has a thriving, vibrant downtown? So we identified all those legal and financial impediments. We started to work on them. We've realized tax and criminal finance is the best tool we had to do that. We also set high standards of architecture, of building and design standards so that Carmel remains a beautiful city. We only have one opportunity to build this city right and set the tone and standards for decades to come. Last fall, we asked the economic researchers at IU's Public Policy Institute to take a measure of our investments and give us a report card, see if they're paying off. And the answer in their report came back, yes, they're paying off as we anticipated. Cities must invest in themselves. Just as a young family invests in a new house or a new business must invest in research and development of new products, we must invest so that taxpayers' investments leverage private sector investments. If we put in a new, I remember back when we first built Hazeldale Parkway and started in January of 1996 planning, and I remember it was a below zero day in January, and one of the consulting engineers came in with big aerial over maps, and we were drawing where Hazeldale Parkway would go on those maps. About a year later, we were able to bond for it and start construction. A bond, I might mention, has been paid off now. But it was all farmland. Within about 4 years after that road was completed, and I should mention Hazeldale was the first road. We added bike paths and added a 70-foot green belt most of the way on either side of the road. Within 4 years after that road was built, we had over $1 billion, that's with a B, of additional assessed value built because of the investment in that road. So the strategy of leveraging our tax dollar investments, we know that we'll get many multiple times a private sector investment. The investments we have made in our growing Central Corridor have led to tens of millions of dollars in private investment in our city. So where's that money go? Well, for starters, it helps feed a lot of families of the construction workers who labor on our projects. It also helps our local businesses and our growing number of local restaurants and shops. Shops and restaurants which we all enjoy. These restaurants and shops are helped because we have made public sector investments in trails, in sidewalks, in better streets, in parking garages, and in events that draw residents and visitors to our downtown. How many cities can you think of across the United States where their downtowns fail? Nobody goes downtown, where all you see is rundown old buildings. That's not the case in Carmel, Indiana. Specifically, we have the Midtown and Monon Boulevard expansion. I think as everyone remembers, we started with the Art and Design District, and we knew that area wasn't large enough. You know, our land, our square miles in Carmel is about double the size of the island of Manhattan, so it's a big area. And so we knew the Art and Design District, it's now the Art and Design District, wasn't large enough to be in a downtown for Carmel, but we made that the Art and Design District, put up the arches. Then we started the City Center project, master plan that new downtown, worked with the private sector to leverage the city's investments. And then there we had that older industrial area in between that we now call Midtown. So we've added the Monon Boulevard. We invested a lot of money in that street and in the Midtown Plaza. But it's paying off because the private sector investment is many multiples of what the taxpayers have put into that area. So you go to the Midtown Plaza, I assume most people have been there at this point. It opened on July 3rd, right before the 4th of July. You have a mix of activities from playing pool and ping pong, watching a movie on our big screen, or simply sitting, people watch, enjoy a movie. It's given our residents another place in which to gather with friends, or make new friends. It's a place for people from all different backgrounds to come together and get to know their neighbors, and that is so important in the United States of America. It's the essence of placemaking. It's an important part of creating a new culture of fellowship and acceptance of our neighbors, of acceptance of people that we might otherwise not have an opportunity to meet. We've won design awards, as I mentioned, the Mona Boulevard expansion, including Midtown Plaza. A charter award from the Congress for New Urbanism is a prestigious national honor. Community Placemaking Award, as I mentioned, from Accelerate Indiana. But the true major success, however, is how we attract members of our community to engage with a place. But watching a group of children meet with each other and start to play games like Duck, Duck, Goose on the grass at Midtown Plaza while their parents sit and enjoy is a wonderful thing. And that's what placemaking is, what building community is all about. We do have challenges. We need to pay closer attention to health and how do we design a healthier community. And there's many ways to design a healthy community. We've ensured that our city has good fiscal health. We've ensured that we have some of the cleanest air, clean water, and a strong wastewater system. We've ensured our residents we have opportunities for physical health by providing over 200 miles of bike trails, park facilities, park programming, and many outdoor events, activities, and festivals. We've ensured our roadways are safe, and we have a safe city with low crime rates. But the last point is actually what made me start thinking about my next topic, which is mental health. Let's contrast it. You know, I can't give a speech without talking about runabouts. So we have a new statistic I've been looking at. You know, cities don't keep good track of how many personal injuries there are. Some cities report them. Somebody may go to the hospital 3 days after an accident. But we generally, national statistics say we have a 75 to 80% reduction in injury accidents with roundabouts over stoplights simply because of speeds. But a statistic that we are all too familiar with is fatalities, traffic fatalities. The U.S. average traffic fatality is 14 per 100,000 per year. It's a lot. The city of Carmel, Indiana, we believe is the best in the United States of America at 2. By contrast, Indianapolis is just under 12 fatalities per 100,000 per year. We're at 2, which means you have a 6 times greater chance of dying in a traffic accident south of 96th Street than you do in Carmel, Indiana. But then we start to look at what's happening in the mental health area. During the last 10 years, we've had 52 suicides in Carmel. 9 of those are from this year alone. 85% of them are men, 15% women. And these individuals range in age from 15 to 85. 55% were over 40, and 45% were younger than 40. And it's disheartening to think that we have members of our city who give up hope at such a young age and don't see a bright future. So I'm hopeful we can improve. In 2018, U.S. News ranked states based on statistics and studies by the Center for Disease Control and National Institute of Mental Health. Indiana, unfortunately, ranked 42nd out of 50 in the United States. We must do better in the city of Carmel. Many organizations, such as International Making Cities Livable, an international conference, which, by the way, is going to meet in Carmel next year, and the Center for Urban Design and Mental Health, have been studying the impact that city design can have not only on one's physical health, but also on mental health. There's a great book out, Urban Sprawl and Public Health, written by a gentleman I've had the opportunity to know, Dick Jackson, who used to teach at the University of California at Los Angeles. He's going to be in Carmel next spring. We'll try to get him to speak. But there's all this new data about how city design impacts not just physical health, but mental health. So we're paying attention to that. We need to do a better job. one quotation I like is, well-designed, and this is from the Center for Urban Design and Mental Health, well-designed urban spaces have a positive influence on people's well-being and help prevent mental health problems developing or becoming worse. We know that trees help. We know that parks. We know that areas where you can meet your neighbors and get to know community members if you're living alone or going through a rough time is so important to mental health. That can be accomplished through better city design. So we're making sure we add green spaces into our built environment with Midtown Plaza, Carter Green, and other spaces. We use these spaces in our programming. Anybody who has visited the new Midtown Plaza or New Urban Park has seen the effect it has on people interacting. I've seen moms and teenage sons playing ping pong. I've seen entire families from grade school children to seniors all engaging together. I've seen children playing with new friends in the grassy areas on summer nights. You see people from all different ages, all different backgrounds, different countries of origin, all coming together in the center of our community. In fact, we've moved our music on OMNI on the Saturday Night Concert Series to Carter Green, create a welcome environment for families who want to picnic and relax on the grass as they listen to music together. The Wednesday night gazebo concerts on the lawn of City Hall have been a staple for years, and we always used to end about the end of July. We extended that series into September now because they've been so popular. We have thousands of people come every Wednesday evening. And when we're attending these events, we may not realize how much this is benefiting our health. Through added relaxation time, time with family, time to connect with old friends, and making new friends. We need to look, you know, government can't fix mental health, but we can help. We can help with making certain that people know how to access services that they may need. Connecting people to the right resources will help. We're building a city that's architecturally beautiful and has the highest quality services and amenities. We build beautiful public places where people of all backgrounds come together and get to know each other better. And we're studying initiatives across the country to find the best practices to help with this mental health statistic, with the suicide statistic, which is not good. It's not where we want to be in this city. We started the Carmel Youth Assistance Program a number of years ago, which identifies at-risk children when they're young, 9, 10, 11, and 12, because the judges in Hamilton County were seeing too many kids, I say kids, young adults, 21, 22, 23, 19, in their courtrooms. And what the Youth Assistance Program does is provide counseling to these kids, helps them become engaged in the community after school activities and so on, provides mentors. As our population in this county is growing, we know that program's working because as that population grows, we've actually seen a decline of those young adults as they get to be older teenagers and in their young 20s actually showing up in court. So we know that program works. Just since 2015, we've had 515 referrals, 515 young adults that have been served. One of the things, I didn't know what this was until recently, one of the things that we can do is get trained. We all know what CPR is, pulmonary resuscitation. I'm talking about QPR, which stands for question, persuade, and refer. This has to do with mental health. Just as people are trained in the life-saving techniques of CPR and the Heimlich maneuver, many in our school system, for instance, are already being trained in QPR, question, persuade, and refer. And the U.S. Surgeon General's National Strategy for Suicide Prevention advocates for people, all of us, to become gatekeepers, which they define as someone in a position to recognize crisis and the warning signs that somebody may be contemplating suicide. As a trained QPR gatekeeper, one learns how to recognize the warning signs of suicide. They learn how to offer hope, and they know how to get help and save a life. And so I encourage everybody that's in a position of authority, whether it's at work, at school, in an NGO, wherever it might be, to recognize a warning, to learn, to get training, recognize warning signs of suicide, know how to offer hope, and know how to help people get help. And as a result, you may save a life. So while we create places for people to get together It's up to each one of us to truly connect with each other and take care of each other. And so if you're interested in this, go to the QPR Institute's website. Some tremendous information there. And we're going to continue to look at best practices from around the country at ways government can help people access the services they need for better mental health. I'm also very proud of what we've done with our park system. You know, there's a feeling in Carmel many years ago that everybody had big lawns and we didn't need any public parks. We kind of forgot about the people that lived in apartments or the people that had small yards. We forgot about the social interaction that takes place in community services. We only had about 40 acres of parkland a day, counting the official parks and the land the city owns, green spaces, school lots, and so on. We have well over 1,000 acres. Again, 40 acres to well over 1,000 acres. And our parks have won award after award for their management and for the programs they offer, for the amenities they offer in our parks. Enloe Park was redesigned the last year and upgraded play areas. It accentuates the location in the wooded area of the park. We opened the Gerald Perlman Pavilion in West Park in time for summer programming. And so our parks department is an important part of making this a quality place to live. Public art. Public art enhances everyday life. We can beautify and elevate everyday life by the beauty and surprise of public art in places that everyone can enjoy. Many of us in this room are, by global standards, are probably some of the wealthiest people on earth. By U.S. standards, we're well off. But yet there are people here in the city of Carmel, as elsewhere, that don't have the money to travel as we do to some of the most beautiful places on earth. They certainly have a right to have the city where they have chosen to live be a beautiful place too, where public art can inspire and motivate them and make their lives better. So we've, for well over a decade now, we've dedicated 1% of our general fund budget to the arts. We also invest in public sculpture and heavy landscaping when we do our road projects or rebuild a road as well. And speaking of road projects, we've got a little one going down at 96 and Keystone. I don't know if you've noticed. Believe it or not, it's almost on time. We're only a couple weeks behind, I'm told. Where's my city engineer? I'm looking at him. We're only a couple weeks behind. It should open up by the holidays, by the Christmas and New Year holidays this year. And it's going to help save lives at the intersection. I think most of you know that even though that's a border road with Indianapolis, state law requires cities to maintain roads in their southern eastern boundaries, so 96 and Keystone is our road. We also added a path project along 126th Street this year, east of Keystone. We're working it on Smoky Row or 136th Street up by the high school. We had that very narrow bridge, and it was dangerous for runners and bikers and walkers to go between Rangeline and Keystone. We're going to continue our Bike Carmel initiatives. Amazes me sometimes how we get earned media. A young man, Dave Schweikert. Anybody know that name? Dave, are you here? Know that he is or isn't, but he's the guy that said he was going to ride around one of our roundabouts for 24 hours. So they got the attention of USA Today, who covered it. So people all over the United States read about Carmel, Indiana, and that's good for economic development. And Dave, by the way, he asked me to do it with him, and I was busy that day. We're continuing to build new roundabouts. We know we save lives. We increase traffic flow by 50%, save the cost of electricity. They work for us. We're continuing the road diet. You know, one of the things, so many times we add lanes to roads simply to build a bigger parking lot, to get more cars through the green cycle of the light. And so we have 4- and 5-lane roads in many places in the community, and now we've replaced the lights with roundabouts. We don't need all those lanes. Wouldn't it be better to have trees down the middle and a wider sidewalk and trees on the side? And that's what we're doing with Rangeline Road, building a beautiful boulevard, which is one of our main streets coming into the community. So a lot of people were concerned when they suddenly had the speed humps to go over and smaller lanes. Well, those smaller lanes were meant to slow down traffic so it's safer for pedestrians and bicyclists. Nobody needs to be speeding through the center of the city. So that's what we've done. And as that area, those trees create a canopy over the street, we know that it'll become a beautiful entrance into downtown Carmel. But that was only phase one of the project. So we're going to continue that project both to the south and the north in coming years. We're also looking at transit. As the Red Line opens in Indianapolis, we have plans that would bring it into Carmel. It would have to be placed on a general election year ballot in the fall, which is an even numbered year, and to place on the ballot, both the township board and the city council would have to vote to place it on the ballot. In addition, as we build more five-story buildings, we don't really want to go higher than that, but that creates substantial density in our downtown areas and enough density that the stores on the ground floor can succeed in business. As we do that, we're looking at whether it makes sense to build a circulator, whether it's a trolley or a bus or a streetcar or a tram, in our central area to get people from place to place. So if you work on the Meridian Corridor, you can come over to the Art and Design District of the City Center for lunch or after work and that sort of thing. So we're in the early stages of this very expensive proposal, so we're studying it very carefully to see what would work the best for Carmel. And we'll be providing that data and starting a community discussion on that in the coming year. I've already talked about the statistics on the roundabouts, but I want to emphasize, we build roundabouts for one major reason, and that is we save lives. 80% reduction in injury accidents. Our traffic fatality rate is a small fraction of most other cities. And interestingly enough, you know, I said that 14 per 100,000 is the normal rate in, across the United States of fatalities per year. Suburbs tend to be higher because the streets were built wider and for faster speeds. So our 2 per 100,000, 1/7 of the U.S. average, is even more drastic statistic in a good way because we are a relatively new suburban area. We're looking now, I think we're going to look at the Proscenium Project and Long Range Lane Road. That's where the big crane is there at Carmel Drive and Range Line. We're excited to see that public-private partnership coming to fruition. It's going to be five buildings. It's going to be walkable. Most of the cars are going to be underground there, so it will be a pedestrian area. We're continuing to work with different developers and community to redevelop Range Line Road from 116th Street up to the Art and Design District. And we're strategic when it comes to how we invest our redevelopment dollars. We analyze those zoning decisions very carefully. We look at the long-term impact it's going to have on the city. Remember June this year? I happened to be out of town. I had good timing, or bad timing, depending on how you look at it. But we had parts of Carmel didn't have electricity for almost 3 days. Remember that? What would happen if we went 5, 6, 7 days, 10 days? California, you know, Northern California had to turn off power to over 7 counties last night and yesterday because of they have high winds coming in, and they're afraid it could spark another wildfire, which would destroy houses and kill people. We have the possibility of tornadoes. Unfortunately, we have the possibility of terrorism, both domestic or otherwise. And so we have to think as city leaders about what would happen if we had an extended period of time without electricity. So we started to look, how would we produce our own electricity in an emergency? What type of return on investment would we get that in an ordinary day as well? For instance, think about, we pump water up in our towers to create pressure for fire safety, so we can open a fire hydrant and actually fight a fire. We had to get the water out of the ground. We use generators when electricity goes out now, but what if we weren't able to get that generator fuel, if that diesel or propane fuel wasn't available after several days? What if we couldn't pump the fuel out of the underground storage tanks at the service stations? So we're looking at photovoltaic displays, or photovoltaic solar panels is the common word, near our water and sewer plants. And we think we can get about a 10% return just using them normally to reduce our electricity costs. We spend almost $1 million a year in electricity just handling water and sewer. But we can also then have a backup, a redundant system in the case we have an extended power outage. So we're looking at that as well. How do we do economic development in the city of Carmel? We do it by focusing on the quality of life. A lot of you have heard me joke, as we're just like Paris and France. Lousy weather, no mountains, and no oceans. And they did just fine. It's about, just as in their case, it's about what we build. Can we build a beautiful city? We have over 126 corporate headquarters here in Carmel that provide all these good jobs and this tremendous tax base. To the extent that those companies can't hire the top-ranked employees, the best and brightest from all over the globe, they're going to find somewhere else to have those corporate headquarters. So it's our role to partner with the private sector, our private sector partners here in this community, to keep, to build the most beautiful city we can, the most exciting city we can. And if we do those things, those headquarters not only will stay here, we can continue to attract more. That's why we invest in public art. That's why we invest in flowers and roundabouts. That's why we invest in making this a beautiful city and focusing on architecture, all the things that we do to make this a beautiful place, a place, you know, employees, the best and brightest employees around the world have choices. They can get a job anywhere, anywhere in the globe, and they have choices as to where they choose to work, where they choose to raise their families, where they choose to spend their lives. And so we have to be a competitive city to be able to attract those people. And if we're able to attract those people, then we can attract the people that want to employ them. Along with that, of course, low tax rates, low utility rates, good transportation systems, great public schools, great public library system, a wonderful park and trail system. If we do all those things, we can compete with the best cities anywhere on the globe. We have been granted the exciting responsibility of helping to build a brand new city, a city where people from across Indiana, from across the United States, and from more than 50 countries across the globe, people from all races, people from all religions and political persuasions, have chosen to make Carmel their home. A city where more than 100,000 people have chosen to live their lives and raise their families. And so it is our responsibility to take bold action, take careful action to build the best city we can. As I said, that's how we compete. But more importantly, it's because we've all chosen to spend our lives here. Cities are places where civilization is advanced. Places where scientists come together to invent things that make life better. Places where artists come to celebrate life and show their creativity. Places where business people come together. Places where medicine is advanced. Places where better products are built. So we must build a city that is safe. We must build a city that attracts continued private and public investment. We must build a city that provides opportunities for people from all walks of life and all backgrounds to thrive. We must build a city that our residents are proud of. We must build a city that people never want to leave. We must build a city with beautiful buildings and parks that inspire people to make great achievements. We must build a city that recognizes that robust public discussion leads to better results. We must build a city of beauty. We must build a city that encourages a culture of inclusion that leads to achievement, success, and service to others. We have made great progress towards building that great city, but we must not falter, we must not stop, and we must not, more than anything else, accept mediocrity. We must excel, we must build that great city that will stand and succeed for generations.